In a speech that ran a little less than 1 hour, Hillary Rodham Clinton becomes the first female nominee of a major political party, or more accurately, accepts the nomination of the Democratic Party to run to become the 45th president of the United States. Inherent throughout her speech, very obvious there, the slogan, "Stronger Together." Also very interesting, listening through the course of this speech, she said in direct contradiction of Donald Trump, she cited a quote that Ronald Reagan used. He credited it to Alexis de Tocqueville. "America is great because America is good." Mrs. Clinton saw no need to cite the source of that observation. She spoke of an America freer, fairer, stronger, and again, pointing out the fact that she was the first female nominee, she said, "When there are no ceilings, the sky's the limit." Obviously, there is much to talk about, and quite candidly, some warning signs to those who believe we live in a constitutional republic rather than a, quote, democracy. And some of the plans that, despite Mrs. Clinton's portrayal as being concrete plans, were really more glittering generalities. To that end, let's welcome back in those who have been watching with us tonight. And let's begin with a former Lieutenant Governor of New York, Betsy McCaughey, joining us via Skype. Oh, we should point out as well that we welcome your calls at 1-877-NEWSMAX. That's 1-877-639-7629. Betsy, as you were listening to Mrs. Clinton's speech, what is the overall impression you're left with?
Well, it was a very unusual acceptance speech because generally the candidate does not spend most of the speech cutting down or criticizing the nominee of the other party. That's generally left to others at the convention, especially the vice presidential nominee. So Mrs. Clinton is clearly feeling the heat of Donald Trump because she has directed almost all her speech at criticizing Donald Trump, suggesting that he does not have the character to serve as commander in chief. That was the number one issue. Number two, her claim to be making history. She is urging voters to make history by electing her president. But I would remind voters to remember history, her history, because she's really gotten everywhere she is on her husband's coattails. Contrary to her own claims, she has not shattered glass ceilings.
Also with us tonight, the economist and syndicated columnist, Peter Morici. Peter, when you heard Hillary-nomics tonight about investment, I'm reminded of what Milton Friedman said, if you want less of something, tax it. And she seems to have quite the plan for extensive and higher taxation in her mind and in her policy in the days ahead, should she become president.
Well, she certainly does. We already have the highest corporate tax rates in the West, much higher, double of what Great Britain has approximately. And further taxing American companies will just cause them to move their headquarters to Ireland. You really can't stop them. You can slow them down. You know, but what really struck me tonight was the symbolism. You know, we've seen her in maroon pantsuits, in green pantsuits, in blue pantsuits. But tonight she came out in papal white. I thought that was rather remarkable symbolism. I mean, this is a woman who views herself as the Messiah. She's America's Evita. And, I mean, all these generalizations, she's going to magically restore jobs through government initiative. What she's basically going to do is build a lot of roads, which will pay off the union labor in the transportation sector. But she didn't address how she's going to bring those factories back. She didn't talk about trade. She didn't talk about the loss of manufacturing to China and so forth in a meaningful way and really offer anything concrete about how this was going to happen. And neither does her website. It's all about giveaways. That's what we really heard. It was the politics of envy. It was the politics of envy. It was the politics of envy. It was a very divisive speech spoken by a woman who has a messianic vision of herself.